Good morning. The Pope, during an interview with 60 Minutes Sunday night, once again went after Catholic conservatives in America, calling their political viewpoints, quote, a suicidal attitude. You got that? Conservative Catholic Republicans, the Pope went after you, calling your political viewpoints, quote, a suicidal attitude. The Pope clarified a previous statement where he said homosexuality is not a crime, telling 60 Minutes, yes, that is a human fact. Homosexuality is not a crime. In the past, the Pope has urged Catholic parents to love and help their LGBTQ children and praised Catholic priests and nuns who counseled members of the LGBTQ community. During his interview on 60 Minutes Sunday, the Pope said members of the LGBTQ community should be blessed by the Church, but wouldn't bring himself to approve of same-sex marriages. The Pope then called climate change, quote, the road to death. He then reiterated that climate destruction is caused by wealthy countries reliant on fossil fuels. The Pope, pay attention to this, my Catholic friends who are Republicans. The Pope said migrants are what allows countries to grow. The Pope criticized the state of Texas for shutting down the border to migrants. The Pope said the migrants, quote, must be received and then considered humanely. The Pope said he understood why some of these migrants may have to be removed from America after they have been properly vetted, but he called it, quote, unquote, sheer madness to leave these migrants waiting at the border to come into America. This is the mop-up for May 21st, 2024. I'm David Feldman in New York City. Thank you so much for finding me. Please like this episode so I remain in your feed. I read all your comments, so please leave one, subscribe to my newsletter, and this channel. If you would like a transcript of today's program or previous ones, they're free. Go to shopdavidfeldman.com, hit the transcripts menu. That's shopdavidfeldman.com. We have posted all the transcripts for the month of May, and moving forward, that's where transcripts will be housed, over at shopdavidfeldman.com. Hit the menu that says transcripts. Thank you to the listeners who bought worthless garbage over at shopdavidfeldman.com. You make the free transcripts possible. The debate between Joe Biden and Donald Trump is scheduled for June 27th, 9 p.m. Eastern, in Atlanta on CNN. It will be anchored by Jake Tapper and Dana Bash. It's going to be decisive. No audience. And I will be genuinely surprised if Donald Trump doesn't back out. Republicans are now saying they want to administer a drug test to see what Joe Biden is, quote unquote, jacked up on. Really? You want to do blood tests? You really want us to discover what's in Trump's blood? I mean, besides tiny, individually wrapped quarter pounders that his doctor mainlines into his veins each morning. That debate is on a Thursday night, and I'm probably hosting a watch party on Zoom. If you don't have Zoom, or if you don't like Zoom, I'll give you a phone number so you can call into it and listen. We'll watch the debate together. Then afterwards, I'll record an episode for Friday's audio podcast. I'll take your calls, answer your questions in the chat room, maybe have a guest or two. And like I said, I'll record an audio version of my podcast, a post-debate wrap-up, but it will not be on YouTube. It will just be for the audio version of this program. By the way, this is an audio podcast. You can take me with you wherever you download your audio. So anyway, let me know if you're interested in attending. Leave a comment and let me know. Again, I'm probably going to charge something to keep the trolls out and to keep the lights on here over the David Feldman Show. It won't be too much. And if you can't afford it, I mean, I'm talking like the cost of a newspaper, like the New York Times. But if you can't afford that, just email me. I'll let you in for free because I'll know you're not a troll. I'm not sure still that I'm going to do this. So let me know in the comments section or contact me at my website if you're interested in attending. By the way, this would be anonymous for all of you. You won't be seen. It's a Zoom webinar, not a Zoom meeting. In the past, when we did these things, everyone can see everybody else, and those days are over. If you want to say something, say it in the chat room or in the Q&A or raise your hand and I'll call on you. In the past, things got way out of hand because everybody was on camera and some of my listeners who were there, some don't know how to behave, including yours truly. It was really my fault. I would look for the participants doing bong hits. Then I'd highlight their video while they were getting stoned and we watched them get... I can't do that anymore, okay? I built a community 4 years ago. It completely fell apart last year. I've learned a few lessons, so if I'm going to try this again, it's got to be way more disciplined and, dare I say, professional. The United States Justice Department, dating back to the Trump administration, has been attempting to extradite Julian Assange, the head of WikiLeaks, and put him on trial, accusing him of Espionage Act violations for making public a trove of classified military documents revealing war crimes committed by American soldiers in Afghanistan and Iraq. While Merrick Garland has continued to pursue Assange, who is currently held in a London jail, President Biden hinted recently he might be willing to drop the charges. And now, just hours before Assange was scheduled to be put on a plane for America, two British judges granted Assange a full appeal, ruling they cannot be certain American prosecutors will grant Assange, who is not an American, full protections under the First Amendment that is guaranteed to all United States citizens. American prosecutors assured the British judges that Assange would be tried in a courtroom that applies First Amendment protections to foreign nationals, but the British judges said they don't trust the United States. Assange's extradition has been tied up by a series of British judges who ruled that Assange shouldn't be extradited for many reasons. One, because America still has the death penalty. Another judge blocked his extradition, citing conditions in American prisons. She said American prisons are so horrible, she feared Julian Assange would end up committing suicide in one. Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer said he's reintroducing that bipartisan border bill that passed earlier in the Senate. I think it was late February, but it died in the Republican-controlled House after Donald Trump ordered Speaker Mike Johnson to kill it, reportedly telling Mike Johnson that Joe Biden cannot get any credit for solving the migrant crisis. This was verified by several sources, including Oklahoma Republican Senator James Lankford, who sponsored the bipartisan border bill, put it together. In the well of the Senate, Republican Senator Lankford said, after his bill died in the House, he said that he received numerous threats because of this bill, and then added it was killed by one man, Donald Trump, because Trump didn't want the migrant crisis solved before the general election. So what's the politics behind Chuck Schumer reintroducing a bipartisan border bill that he knows will never get passed? Well, the presidential debate is a little more than a month away, and by reintroducing the bipartisan border bill now, he gives Biden a cudgel to say, Mr. Trump, you talk about the border. Come on, man, there's a bill. Why won't you support it? This time around, Biden will be able to say during the debate, this time around, the border bill is not attached to any funding for Ukraine. It's a standalone border bill. Why won't you join me in trying to solve the migrant crisis? This border bill is the most transformative in 30 years. Why won't you sign it? Well, between you and me, it's crap and it's racist, but this is politics. According to Politico, the other reason Schumer is reintroducing the border bill is to give Democratic senators running for re-election another chance to vote for it so they can convince voters, I'm strong on immigration. Democratic Senator John Tester in Montana, Jackie Rosen in Nevada, Sherrod Brown in Ohio, Tammy Baldwin in Wisconsin, and Bob Casey in Pennsylvania. These senators must win in order for Democrats to hold on to the upper house. So, by reintroducing this border bill, they can all cast a vote in favor of it to prove to voters back home they're tough on the border crisis that doesn't actually exist. But unfortunately, Trump and Fox News have done a terrific job convincing enough Americans that it does. Let me know if you'd like to attend a debate watch party Thursday night, starting at 9 p.m. Eastern on June 27th. Go to my website, leave a comment, or leave one in the comments section of this episode. Trump Media issued its first quarterly earnings statement since going public in March. The earnings report was delayed a few weeks because the company's accounting firm was banned earlier in the month by the SEC after it was found to have committed massive fraud. How unusual. Trump is known for only surrounding himself with the most honest people. You know, like his chief financial officer, Alan Weisselberg, who just started his second stint inside Rikers Island, this time for committing perjury during the trial that convicted the Trump Organization of tax fraud. Well, a new accounting firm is working for Trump Media, and they finally put together the financials for the first quarter, and Trump Media reported revenue of $770,000, lost more than $300 million in the first quarter of 2024. Revenue of $770,000. They lost $300 million. Where is that $300 million going? According to Fortune magazine, Devin Nunes, the former Republican congressman turned CEO of Trump Media, will earn a $1 million base salary this year. Okay? On revenue for the first quarter, that was $770,000. The company lost $300 million last quarter. It's on pace to lose $1.2 billion this year. Where is the money going? Where has it gone? Probably the same place the Save America PAC money went. Donald Trump raised hundreds of millions of dollars with his Save America PAC to investigate voter fraud, and nobody knows where the money went. We know about $100 million of it went to lawyers. Nobody knows where the rest of it went. Kid Rock, one of rock and roll's biggest and loudest MAGA supporters, who was welcomed to the Trump White House on several occasions, reportedly shouted the N-word while waving a gun at a reporter during an interview with Rolling Stone magazine. Rolling Stone reporter David Peisner's piece on Kid Rock was published Sunday. Kid Rock, according to the article, downed several alcoholic beverages in quick succession, began waving his handgun, and then shouted the N-word several times throughout the interview. Peisner writes in Rolling Stone that he couldn't help but wonder if Kid Rock spewed the N-word so he could then use the article in Rolling Stone as an opportunity to rail against cancel culture. Maybe. Or maybe Kid Rock is a racist. Maybe it has nothing to do with cancel culture. Maybe Kid Rock shouts the N-word when he's had too much to drink because he's a racist, which is why he's one of rock and roll's loudest MAGA supporters. Yes, I said rock and roll. By the way, black women are not voting for Trump. Get that out of your head. Black people are not voting for Trump. You look at Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin, the three states Biden must win. Black women, even if they're evangelical or Catholic and they're living in the suburbs or if they're living in rural areas or the city, they are not voting for Trump. I've gone over the polls. High school degree, some college, postgraduate degrees. Black women in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania are voting for Joe Biden. I don't know why they keep writing stories about Joe Biden losing the black vote. He's not losing the black female vote in the three states where he needs them, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. In Michigan, Biden only has a problem. I've pored over the polls last night. Biden only has a problem with black evangelical men who live in rural areas and have just a high school education. Let me repeat that. The only problem that Joe Biden has with black voters, black evangelical men who live in rural areas and have just a high school education. In Michigan, in Pennsylvania, not Wisconsin. He's solid with all black voters in Wisconsin. Give a black male some college, according to the polls, or move him into the suburbs of the city. It is a blowout for Joe Biden among black men in Michigan. With a high school education, with some college, with a postgraduate degree. That's Biden's only weakness in the black community. In Michigan and in Pennsylvania, his only weakness is black evangelical men living in rural districts with only a high school education. Did I say Pennsylvania? Biden is only weak. Black women across the board, they're all voting for Biden. You want a black woman, Catholic, evangelical, with no high school, living in the country, she's voting for Biden. The problem, there's a tiny problem with black evangelical men with only a high school degree living in rural areas in Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan. And how many black evangelical men live in the woods of Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania who only have a high school degree? How many? Not many. So, I am getting really tired of hearing how Biden is losing the black vote. Yes, Trump is doing a little better this time around with black voters, okay? For example, Instead of black Catholic men with a high school education living in a Wisconsin urban area, voting for Biden over Trump by 54 points, they're voting for Biden over Trump by 34 points. It's a slightly smaller blowout. Now, if you want to fill the pages of your magazine insisting that's proof Trump is stealing the black vote from Biden, knock yourself out. I know that elections are a multi-billion dollar business for the news media, and they need to fill pages, and they need to keep us frightened. But listen to me. Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan, that's all that matters. And Biden is going to win the black vote by a landslide in the city, in the suburbs, and in rural areas. He's going to have trouble with a handful of black evangelical men living out in the country who only have a high school education. So stop it. Just knock it off. I know you have to fill time. Knock it off. Nikki Haley is the only high-profile Republican who has yet to reveal whether she's voting for Trump or willing to support him in November. The Associated Press suggests, with the primary season still not over, and Haley on the receiving end of protest votes, sometimes as much as 20%, it would be counterproductive for her right now to endorse the former president. Haley, who served as Trump's UN ambassador, has reportedly not spoken to Trump in months. Axios reported earlier this month that Trump was considering her as a running mate. You might remember last month, before Axios reported this, I said I wouldn't be surprised if Haley was on Trump's shortlist, especially because we're not hearing her name mentioned as a possible running mate, and Trump likes surprises. A lot of you wrote to me and said he would never pick a woman of color, especially one of Indian descent who converted to Christianity. Okay, I'm not sure about that. She is a formidable fundraiser, and he needs that. And one-fifth of Republicans who voted in the primaries this year voted for her and are still voting for her. Biden is actively courting her supporters. So it makes sense for Donald Trump, perhaps, to pick her. But Donald Trump is severely mentally ill, and he's getting worse. USA Today is now reporting that Trump has absolutely no intention of picking her. Why? At this stage in Trump's psychological deterioration, it's all about loyalty. He's in the bunker. And Haley's refusal to endorse him after dropping out still stings. Trump has even intimated that he's not interested in courting Haley's endorsement or her voters, because this time around, Mein Fuhrer wants absolute loyalty. That's why anyone who wants to be vice president, anyone who wants just to court him, every low-level Republican hack is showing up at Trump's trial here in Manhattan. Now, it will not surprise me if Trump picks someone completely out of left field. This may be his Sarah Palin moment, you know, where McCain blew it by picking Sarah Palin. Something tells me he's going to pick a Sarah Palin type, and that will be the bridge too far. That's when people will abandon him. It'll be someone who probably never even showed up to his trial. Now, if he's smart, he'll pick, this is what I think, okay, right now. I may change my mind in a couple of minutes, but right now, I think a smart move for Trump is picking Haley or Marco Rubio. Maybe Tim Scott, maybe Byron Donalds. I suspect, however, Trump is being advised by what's left of the old guard Republican Party. I suspect Wall Street, the big donors, are saying pick Nikki Haley because the donors love her. If you can't do that, pick Marco Rubio. Marco Rubio would be the best. And if you're a Republican, the most responsible choice. I can't stand him. Rubio, however, you know, if you're a Republican, he is smart. He's politically astute, and he understands policy. And I remember him in 2016, and he was the only one in the debates who was facile enough to play with Trump, to stay in the moment and talk back to him with ad libs. Marco Rubio is very sharp. Don't approve of anything about him, but I'm just saying it would be a smart pick to choose Rubio. I know he's from Florida. Trump is from Florida. A lot of us initially thought that would be a problem. Nothing in the Constitution about that. There's something, I think, in the Electoral Reform Act, if two candidates from the same ticket are from the same state and it gets thrown into the House of Representatives, it could be problematic, but there are workarounds. It's a non-issue. J.D. Vance is also considered a good choice because he's only been in the Senate for 2 years. He doesn't have a paper trail. He's a clean slate. So these are repulsive people. I'm going to predict. I like to make predictions. I'm going to make a prediction soon. I'm still sorting this out. If I had to predict now, I'd say Marco Rubio. I think that's a smart pick for Trump, but he's an idiot. Donald Trump's youngest son graduated from high school last week, and before that, there was talk he would join Eric and Don Jr. at the convention in Milwaukee. Trump's youngest son, we were told this before graduation, this was about 2 weeks ago, that he was going to be a Trump delegate from Florida. It was reported in the New York Times. But then his mother nixed the idea. The Trump campaign was prepared to make the big announcement that there we go, I got the beeping sound. Damn it. The Trump campaign was prepared to make the big announcement that the youngest son was joining the family business before going off to college, but Melania said absolutely not. I wonder why. Why wouldn't she want him hanging out with his older brothers, Eric and Don Jr.? Here is Eric Trump on Fox the other day.
110 subpoenas in the last 7 years. Those are ones that I've received personally. 110 subpoenas in 7 years. I've never gotten so much as a traffic ticket. We're a good family. Never have done anything wrong.
I've never gotten so much as a traffic ticket. Probably, Eric, because you're too stupid to pass the driver's test and you've been chauffeured since you were 17. 110 subpoenas. We're a good family. We've never done anything wrong. Really? How about the Eric Trump Foundation? How about that? Huh? How about that? How about the Eric Trump Foundation raising hundreds of thousands of dollars for kids with cancer by staging benefits at one of Trump's golf courses so the country club could pocket hundreds of thousands of dollars in fees for staging the event for St. Jude's? Who rips off kids with cancer? The Trump family. Eric Trump, according to Forbes, helped his father pocket hundreds of thousands of dollars a year raising money for kids with cancer. And Eric Trump's wife, Lara, is one of the heads of the RNC now. There's no way she would loot those donations that Republicans are making. In December of 2019, New York State Attorney General Letitia James sued then-President Trump, and he settled. He agreed to shut down the Trump Charitable Foundation and admitted that he admitted in his plea deal that he used his Trump Foundation to rip off several nonprofit organizations. He did it 19 times. He admitted to misusing charitable funds, and he agreed to dissolve the Trump Charitable Foundation. He is permanently barred from starting a charity in New York State or holding any charity functions unless they're under the direct supervision of the New York State Attorney General's office. You know, under normal circumstances, stealing money from kids with cancer, that would kill somebody's political career. Let me go. This is from the New York State Attorney General's office in December of 2019. She's announcing her settlement with then-President Donald Trump. Let me read this. This is a statement from New York State Attorney General Letitia James, she who got the, $500 million fraud settlement out of Trump? Okay. As part of a resolution of the lawsuit announced on November 7th, Trump was ordered to pay $2 million or $250,000 apiece to eight different charities. Those charities are, and this is those charities are Army Emergency Relief. He ripped off the soldiers. Those charities are Army Emergency Relief, the Children's Aid Society, City Meals on Wheels, Give an Hour, Martha's Table, the United Negro College Fund, the United Way of National Capital Area, and the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. He stole money from the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. He stole money from kids with cancer and from the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. Letitia James goes on to write, additionally, Trump was forced to reimburse his namesake foundation, $11,525, for sports paraphernalia and champagne purchased at a charity gala, which was added to $1,797,590.30 already in the foundation's bank account. The combined $1,809,123.30 was split evenly and recently transferred to the eight agreed-upon charities. Each charity ended up receiving a total of $476,140.41. Nothing about the Eric Trump Foundation making hundreds of thousands of dollars a year for the Trump organization by hosting charity events for kids with cancer. Wow. You think maybe that might be the reason Melania doesn't want her son near Trump or his kids? Or maybe it's because, according to ProPublica and the New York Times, Donald Trump probably owes the United States government an additional $100 million in back taxes, in addition to the money he already owes the IRS. ProPublica, working with the New York Times, got its hands on an IRS audit revealing that Trump took illegal write-offs on Trump Tower in Chicago, and that a years-long audit has him owing on Trump Tower, Chicago alone, $100 million in back taxes. The Times reported last week that the $100 million tax bill would be added to the nearly $73 billion the IRS now claims Trump owes the government for taking an illegal refund back in 2010. This is why Melania is still with him. He has nothing to give her in a divorce settlement. She might be the one paying alimony. Or maybe it's because Stormy Daniels. Stormy says if Trump is found innocent in the Manhattan criminal trial, she will leave the country. Maybe that's a reason Melania doesn't want Trump's youngest son anywhere near the Trump family. It is just one indignity after another for the Trumps. Eric Trump, whose foundation made hundreds of thousands of dollars off children with cancer, appeared on Fox News to discuss the endless indignities he and his family are suffering, having to sit through Donald's Manhattan criminal trial.
Then I get to watch and sit right behind my father in the first pew.
Wait. You have to sit behind your father in the first what?
First pew.
The first pew. Wow, that's how bad his father's farts are. They're calling the seats in the Manhattan courtroom pews. It sounds to me like Eric Trump needs to go to shopdavidfeldman.com and buy one of my Donald Trump fart filtration masks. These are industrial strength Trump fart filtration masks, the kind the pros use. Let me go big here. The new Trump, it's new and improved. It's a Trump fart filtration mask made with 5% elastane. This is what crime scene professionals wear. Make sure to buy a Trump fart filtration mask now before I run out. The convention is coming up. You know Republicans hoard things. They're going to hoard Trump fart filtration masks. Go to shopdavidfeldman.com and buy the official Donald Trump fart filtration mask. Don't let a Trump fart scorch your lungs. Go ahead, Eric Trump.
No one believes that the Democrats are going after my father for 34 felony counts. Think about this, 34 felony counts for a $130,000 retainer to a lawyer that was billed as a retainer from a lawyer to a lawyer that was booked as a legal expense.
Yes, that's exactly the crime, Eric. You just said it. That's a crime. You cannot book $130,000 as a legal expense when, in fact, it's being used to silence a porn star your father had unprotected sex with just weeks after your stepmother gave birth to your stepbrother. Prosecutors in the Manhattan criminal trial charging Donald Trump with forging documents and breaking campaign finance law in order to hide those hush money payments to Stormy Daniels in the lead up to the 2016 presidential election have rested their case. Closing arguments in Donald Trump's Manhattan criminal trial are expected to begin next week. And despite Donald Trump promising to testify, he will not be committing, he will not take the stand. He is a coward. He will not take the stand because he will perjure himself. During testimony yesterday, Michael Cohen, Donald Trump's former attorney and fixer, admitted he overcharged the Trump Organization by about $30,000 when he submitted an invoice claiming he paid a tech firm $50,000 to fix an online poll to make Donald Trump appear more popular than he actually was during the lead-up to the 2016 presidential election. Cohen said Trump refused to pay the company, and Cohen eventually got around to reimbursing them, but when he did, he told the Trump Organization that they owed $50,000, when in fact they only owed the tech firm $20,000, which allowed him to pocket $30,000. Cohen said he billed the extra money to punish Trump for cutting his annual bonus that year. Before leaving the Trump Organization, Cohen said he was earning roughly $4 million a year. Since coming out of prison, he said, through various podcasts, other ventures, and book deals, he's been able to start hitting $4 million a year again. Judge Juan Mershon said the trial will probably be dark for the rest of the week. Trump supplicants on Monday paraded into the courtroom to show support for the man who either has or will screw them over. Andrew Giuliani, the son of Rudy Giuliani, continues to show up outside the courthouse telling anyone who will listen that Trump is being railroaded by a corrupt district attorney. He's saying this despite the fact that Giuliani's father is owed at least $2 million by Trump for the so-called legal services he provided in the lead-up to January 6. Also showing up to lend support for Donald Trump on Monday was former New York City Police Commissioner Bernard Kerik, who served while Rudy was mayor. Kerik worked for Rudy in the lead-up to January 6, traveling to swing states, trying to find evidence of voter fraud. Testifying before Special Counsel Jack Smith, Bernard Kerik reportedly said he too, like Rudy, was never paid by Donald Trump. And he wants to know where all the hundreds of millions of dollars Trump raised immediately after the 2020 election, promising to investigate voter fraud, where did it go? Kerik reportedly told the special counsel, "I didn't get any of that." But there was Kerik kissing the ring on Monday. Bernard Kerik, the former police commissioner of New York City under Rudy Giuliani, who made it illegal for black people in New York City to leave their home. This is from the December 15th, 2004 edition of the New York Times. There's so many things I could tell you about Bernard Kerik, one of which is he got a realtor to, right after 9/11, to donate an apartment for first responders who were traumatized going through the rubble at Ground Zero, and Bernard Kerik ended up using the apartment to cheat on his wife. He brought two women to the apartment that was set aside for 9/11 first responders. They couldn't get in to shower, to nap, to sleep, because Bernard Kerik was carrying on two adulterous affairs, one with, I believe, the publisher, Judith Regan. This is from the New York Times. An apartment in Battery Park City that former police commissioner Bernard B. Carrick secured for his personal use after September 11th was originally donated for the use of wary police and rescue workers who were helping at Ground Zero, according to a real estate executive who has been briefed about the apartment. Yeah, that was from the December 15th, 2004 edition of the New York Times. Eventually, Bernard Carrick started paying rent on this apartment that had been set aside for first responders, but it was way below market rates because, you know, 9/11, you can't charge Rudy Giuliani's police commissioner market rates for an apartment near Ground Zero so that he uses to cheat on his wife. Bernard Carrick served 3 years in federal prison on a 4-year sentence for tax fraud and making false statements. That would be Rudy's police commissioner, who, after he was no longer police commissioner, served 3 years of a 4-year federal prison sentence. In 2020, he was granted a full pardon by Donald Trump, so he didn't get paid to plant evidence of voter fraud. Trump figured, I pardoned you? The least you can do was investigate voter fraud for free. Also in the courtroom yesterday was Trump's lawyer and close advisor Boris Epstein, who went to college with Eric Trump. And Boris Epstein was indicted last month for participating in the Arizona false electors scheme. In 2014, he was arrested in Arizona for misdemeanor assault after getting into a bar fight. The charges were dropped after he agreed to attend anger management classes. In 2021, he was arrested again in an Arizona nightclub for disorderly conduct and fighting and agreed to seek alcohol treatment. All this in Arizona. Charges of sexual assault, repeatedly groping two women, were eventually dropped. But some women came forward. The reason he got arrested in 2021 was because two women claimed he was drunkenly and aggressively groping them. There he is. There is Boris Epstein on the ground as Arizona police officers are about to arrest him. Also attending court on Monday to show support for Donald Trump was Chuck Zito, founder of the Nomads, a biker gang associated with the Hells Angels. The New York Times says Zito did a 6-year term in federal prison for drug dealing. These are the people who showed up in the courtroom to lend support. Also showing up to lend support was Georgia Congressman Republican Andrew Clyde, who proudly sells AR-15s. As the owner of the largest gun store in Georgia, he has a side hustle selling weapons and ammunition to the federal government and police departments around the country. This is Congressman Andrew Clyde. He's the loyal patriot who famously said January 6th looked like a normal tourist visit to him. To him, yes. Last week, freshman Republican from Florida, Corey Mills, joined Florida Congressman Byron Donalds and Vivek Ramaswamy to attend the trial. You might remember Vivek Ramaswamy. He ran for president this year. His parents weren't American citizens when he was born here in America. But despite being the beneficiary of birthright citizenship, Vivek Ramaswamy now wants to eliminate birthright citizenship. And his father still isn't an American citizen. His mother, a psychiatrist, eventually became an American citizen. But his father will not become an American citizen. Anyway, Corey Mills on the left. You might remember Congressman Corey Mills tried to ingratiate himself with all the members of Congress at the beginning of 2023, the first days of the new Congress. Corey Mills gave each and every congressperson a 4-millimeter grenade made for a MK-19 grenade launcher. To be fair, the grenade was, just like Corey Mills, a dummy. Corey Mills is a defense contractor who brags that he sold tear gas used on Black Lives Matter protesters. Also showing up to lend support to Trump on Monday was Texas House Republican Keith Self. He's a deeply religious Christian who said after a gunman opened fire in his congressional district last year, killing 8 people, including several children, that what America needs is less gun control legislation and more prayer. He went on CNN and said people who think gun control is necessary, quote, are people that don't believe in an almighty God. And there he is, this devout Christian, Keith Self, Congressman Keith Self, lending emotional support on Monday to an adjudicated rapist, Donald Trump, who is on trial for trying to cover up the fact that he had unprotected sex with a porn star just weeks after his wife gave birth to their son. This is Ernst Röhm. He didn't show up to lend support for Trump on Monday because Ernst Röhm was murdered on July 1st, 1934, during Hitler's Night of the Long Knives. But after going through this laundry list of devoted Trump supplicants in our government showing up to support Trump by intimidating the judge and jury, I would be remiss in not including Ernst Röhm among this distinguished group of professionals who showed up to support Donald Trump. Ernst Röhm was not there, but he was there in spirit. If you want to understand who Donald Trump surrounds himself with, find out who Ernst Röhm is. That'll explain everything. Ernst Röhm, also showing up to lend support Monday for Donald Trump, was Illinois House Republican Mary Miller, who, right after the Dobbs decision in 2022, stood in front of Donald Trump during a Save America rally and called the overturning of Roe, quote, an historic victory for white life. An historic victory for white life. Speaking of Ernst Röhm, she recently addressed Moms for Liberty and quoted a speech from Hitler's. She was also one of 21 House Republicans who voted against awarding the Congressional Gold Medal to Capitol Police officers who defended the Capitol on January 6. So, with many of those wonderful Americans sitting in the room on Monday, Robert Costello took the stand. Now, Michael Cohen testified that Robert Costello, he's a former prosecutor who became a legal advisor to Cohen and the Trump Organization. Cohen testified that Michael Costello pressured Cohen not to flip. Cohen testified that Costello urged Cohen not to talk to the FBI and offered to create a back-channel communication with Trump through Rudy Giuliani. It was during Costello's testimony yesterday when Judge Juan Mershon became angry and ordered everyone, including the media, out of the room. Now think about who's in the room, okay? All somebody from the Hell's Angels, Boris Epstein. I mean, all these people facing criminal trials or been pardoned. These are dangerous, dangerous people in the courtroom lending support. And there is Robert Costello testifying, and he starts stink-eyeing Judge Juan Mershon. He felt, Costello apparently felt empowered, seeing Trump, the leader of a biker gang. Before throwing everyone out of the courtroom, Judge Mershon yelled at Robert Costello and said he didn't like the way Costello was looking at him. He asked, this is what the judge asked, are you staring me down right now? Now, Costello was introduced by the defense to prove Cohen had perjured himself. Mershon, Judge Mershon, grew angry with Costello, who would, during his testimony, grunt, often mutter geez, or wave his arms around when Judge Juan Mershon would sustain objections from prosecutors. Judge Mershon eventually said furiously to him, what did you say? What did you just say? Judge Mershon reportedly told Costello, quote, if you don't like my rulings, then you don't give me side eye and you don't roll your eyes, unquote. After he said that to Costello, Costello reportedly continued to stare at the judge menacingly. And that was when Juan Mershon cleared the room. Mershon then told Costello, when the room was cleared, according to the transcripts, he said, I am putting you on notice that your conduct is contemptuous. If you try to stare me down one more time, I will remove you from the stand. Judge Mershon then warned that if he removes him from the stand, all his testimony would be struck from the record. This is, I've never seen anything like this before, where you load the courtroom up with mobsters, the lunatic fringe of the Republican Party with who celebrate violence, and then you got this guy, Costello, staring menacingly at the judge. Ernst Röhm, baby. Find out who Ernst Röhm was. This is the mop-up for May 21st, 2024. I'm David Feldman in New York. Please hit the like button. Share this episode, please. That's the best way to help me. And subscribe to this channel. If you would like a transcript of this episode, they're free. Go to shopdavidfeldman.com, hit the transcript menu, and you can download them for free. John Eastman, Donald Trump's outside attorney in the lead up to January 6, pleaded not guilty in Arizona after he was indicted last week for helping to orchestrate the false elector scheme in that statement. Eastman earlier this year was disbarred by the state of California, which has suspended his law license, probably permanently. Eastman is also on trial in the Georgia RICO trial for, among other things, orchestrating the false elector scheme in that state. Rudy Giuliani was also indicted by the Arizona grand jury for the role he played in orchestrating Arizona's false elector scheme, but Giuliani was shuttling back and forth between New York and Florida, making it impossible for Arizona marshals to serve him. So he taunted them. Rudy posted on Twitter Friday a photograph of him standing with a group of young people at his 80th birthday party and then bragging, you can't find me, Arizona. He said on Twitter that if Arizona can't find me, they must dismiss the indictment. No. But he said that, and he said, and they must concede they can't count votes. He was taunting the prosecutors. He was saying, you can't find me. Well, Hours later, they found him, and it got ugly. Rudy turns 80 next week, and that Twitter post, as I said, was made during a big birthday celebration for him in Palm Beach, Florida, Friday. It was attended by 200 guests, including Roger Stone and Steve Bannon, both of whom were pardoned by Donald Trump. And this big birthday bash for Rudy got interrupted by a process server who handed Rudy his papers. Women at the party began crying. They screamed. Rudy lowered his head, took the papers, got in his car. Why me? Why me? Rudy is in bankruptcy court, and he is set to owe $500 million in court judgments and unpaid legal and accounting fees. So to pay his bills, Rudy launched Rudy Coffee. You can actually buy Rudy Coffee online. He's offering a decaf and a morning blend called Get These Spiders to Stop Crawling Underneath My Skin. Rudy says his beans are smooth, rich, and chocolatey, and easy on the stomach. In his promotional video for the coffee, Rudy assures us, quote, "If I put my name on something, I truly believe it," which is precisely why you, Rudy, are $500 million in debt hawking coffee beans. So why are they making you do this? Why are you broke, Rudy Giuliani?
And you want to stop me, don't you?
That's what he said when he got fired from his radio show. He said,
"And you want to stop me, don't you?"
Well, it's sad that America's mayor has sunk to this level, hawking coffee beans. I mean, come on. You don't see me promoting shopdavidfeldman.com, telling you to drink Rudy's coffee from one of my new Father's Day mugs, like World's Second Greatest Dad. Sure, I mean, I'm selling World's Second Greatest Dad coffee mugs so you could buy it for Father's Day, but I wouldn't stoop so low as to tell people to buy them over at shopdavidfeldman.com. What do you think, Rudy, huh? Or I could, you know, tell you to buy a World's Creepiest Stepdad coffee mug at shopdavidfeldman.com. I have way too much self-respect to use this show to promote my World's Creepiest Stepdad coffee mug over at shopdavidfeldman.com, unlike you, Rudy. Or I could pitch my Made in Los Estados Unidos coffee mug, which people seem to love, or my official Donald Trump fart filtration masks. This is what they look like up close. I mean, yeah, I could tell you to buy all this over at shopdavidfeldman.com, but unlike Rudy, I have too much self-respect. David Ferdman? Oh, Leonard, I told you to fix... We're still selling David Ferdman. There's a David Ferdman Show coffee mug and a David Ferdman Show t-shirt and a David Ferdman... My sister's son is running the shop, and he promised me he fixed... It's not the David Ferdman Show. Well, we printed up hundreds of these. Anyway, God damn him. Leonard, Donald Trump says if elected, he would consider nominating Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton as his own Attorney General. Not Rudy. Surprising. Too bad. Paxton, as Texas Attorney General, filed a lawsuit before the Supreme Court in the immediate aftermath of the 2020 presidential election, calling into question election results in key swing states like Pennsylvania and Arizona that Joe Biden won. The Supreme Court refused to hear the case despite an amicus brief written by Mike Johnson, signed by nearly 100 House Republicans. Last year, Ken Paxton was impeached by the Texas House, accused of accepting bribes from a local businessman, he won an acquittal in the Senate. Before going to trial, facing similar charges earlier this month, Paxton worked out a plea deal with prosecutors where he agreed to pay back investors who he ripped off and perform court-ordered community service. This is who Donald Trump may appoint as Attorney General, Ken Paxton. Good news for Joe Biden in Arizona. A brand new CBS poll of likely voters shows Democratic Congressman Ruben Gallego beating the likely Republican nominee Carrie Lake in that state's race for Senate by 13 points. Now, I told you on the last show, polls are important, but you got to pay attention to the right ones. This has been this 13 percentage point lead that Ruben Gallego has over Carrie Lake. It has been a consistent number, way outside the margin of error, since it became clear that it was going to be Gallego versus Lake. Why is this good news for Joe Biden? And please, please pay attention to this, because a lot of my friends are freaking out. Why is this good news when the same CBS poll shows Biden trailing Donald Trump by 5 points? Because that poll isn't based in reality. There will be no ticket splitting in Arizona come November. Real party enthusiasm is measured by down ballot candidates like Ruben Gallego, who's running for senator. How Ruben Gallego does reveals how voters in Arizona really feel about Democrats and Republicans. Joe Biden leads from behind. He is going to be the beneficiary of Ruben Gallego's updraft. There's a reason, you know, I'm getting angry because the media is freaking out a lot of people about Biden's poll numbers. So listen to me. There's a reason Democrats are working feverishly right now to put abortion measures on as many ballots as possible. Okay? It's the updraft for Joe Biden. Putting abortion on the ballot gets, and it's good for women who want to get abortions, but it gets voters to the polls. Republicans, on the other hand, have zero down ballot measures to animate their base. They only have Donald Trump, and Trump has a ceiling. Okay? What Democrats also have, besides abortion being on the ballot, is Donald Trump on the ballot. So people are going to turn out in droves either to vote for abortion or against Trump. And Carrie Lake in Arizona is pretty much the same thing as Trump. There will be no ticket splitting, okay? Arizona Democrats aren't sure about many things, but as we approach November, we know one thing. They don't like Carrie Lake. We will see Biden and Trump's polling in Arizona rocking back and forth. But what will remain consistent is the contempt a vast majority of Arizona voters feel for Carrie Lake. She, Carrie Lake, and Donald Trump has said this. Donald Trump has said, Carrie Lake is going to end up losing Arizona for me. She is a lightning rod that will get voters to the poll, to the polls in November to cast a ballot for Congressman Ruben Gallego. And just like an abortion measure, you put these abortion measures on the ballot. If Ruben Gallego's on the ballot, it's like an abortion measure. They're going to vote for Biden. Nobody in Arizona is voting for Ruben Gallego and then voting for Trump. Nobody, nobody is going to vote for Ruben Gallego and withhold a vote for Joe Biden. And he's leading Carrie Lake by 13 points. That's the poll you look at. That's where the enthusiasm is. Hold on to Arizona for a second. Some of you ask why I'm so certain Biden wins in November. Well, there's some very simple math. I'm going to go big here. This is the 2020 electoral map. Is this the right one? Yes. Yes, okay. This is the 2020 electoral map. And this is all you need to know about this. Biden wins five states in 2020. He wins five states that Hillary didn't win. He wins Georgia. This is 2020. He won Georgia, Arizona, and then the big blue wall of Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan. Now, look at this map. In the next 5 months, you're going to keep hearing about Arizona. You're going to be hearing Biden's going to lose Arizona. He's not. But you're going to start seeing polling with him in trouble there. You're going to hear that he's losing in Georgia. That he might. You're going to hear that he's losing in Nevada. He won't. Okay? First of all, abortion is literally going to be on. Let me just address Nevada for a second. Abortion is literally, we just found out, abortion is literally going to be on the ballot in Nevada. Nevadans for Reproductive Freedom just announced they have 200,000 signatures, twice the number needed to get a measure on the ballot in November, calling for a woman's right to an abortion being enshrined in Arizona, in Nevada's state constitution. It's really popular. The deadline for the signatures was June 26. They're a month ahead of schedule. They got twice the signatures they need. Now, abortion is legal in Nevada up until the 24th week. But next door in Nevada, next door in Arizona, it's legal up until 15 weeks with no exceptions for rape and incest. So, abortion is going to be on the ballot. The state officials in Nevada have to validate the signatures, but it's going to be on the ballot. And this is precise. This is the updraft, right? Biden leads from behind. He is not going to have the coattails of, say, LBJ or FDR. He relies on the updraft from the abortion measures or from popular candidates running down ballot. The Democrats want their base coming out for abortion because lately what we're seeing now is some lukewarm feelings about Biden. Okay, Nevada. Jackie Rosen is the Democratic senator. She's the incumbent running for re-election. The Nevada primary is June 11th. Her likely Republican opponent is going to be Sam Brown, a small business owner, and he's a veteran. The New York Times Siena survey is rated one of the most accurate pollsters in the country. They nailed it. The New York Times Siena survey nailed it in 2022. One of the top polls from the 2022 midterms. They show Jackie Rosen, Democrat, beating Sam Brown among registered voters by 2 points. It's within the margin of error, but Nevada is always tight. Democrats always win in Nevada, but it's always tight. Rosen, Jackie Rosen, has three distinct advantages. She's the incumbent. As I keep saying, abortion will be on the ballot. And Sam Brown never won elective office. So he's not coming into this with a built-in get-out-the-vote infrastructure he'd have if he were, say, a congressman or a state legislator. It's also important to remember that Nevada's Republican Party is in shambles and broke. Back in December of last year, Nevada's state GOP chair, Michael McDonald, he's still the state chair of the Republican Party in Nevada. He was among six Republican officials indicted for participating in that state's 2020 false elector scheme. His trial begins in 2025. He's got things on his mind, and the Republican Party in Nevada, because of the false elector scheme, is financially strapped, paying for lawyers. Meanwhile, Sam Brown, who is Rosen's likely challenger, we'll know next month, he ran for the Republican nomination for Senate in 2022, and he lost to Adam Laxalt, who went on to lose to Democratic incumbent Senator Catherine Masto. Now, you might remember Adam Laxalt, besides being a former Attorney General of Arizona, besides being a huge Trump supporter, and this is really important. I've talked about this. Adam Laxalt is also the illegitimate son of New Mexico Republican Senator Pete Domenici and the daughter of Nevada Republican Senator Paul Laxalt. Let me repeat, okay? This is very important. Republican Adam Laxalt is the illegitimate son of New Mexico Republican Senator Pete Domenici and the daughter of Nevada Republican Senator Paul Laxalt. Pete Domenici, Republican, voted to convict Bill Clinton, who was impeached for lying about his affair with Monica Lewinsky. Meanwhile, Pete Domenici had an illegitimate son. Nobody's illegitimate. But Adam Laxalt calls them illegal immigrants. So nobody's illegal. You can't call, it's a sin to call undocumented people illegals. I wouldn't stoop so low as to call Adam Laxalt an illegitimate child. I'm better than that. He's a bastard, but he's not illegitimate. Anyway, Sam Brown lost to Adam Laxalt. And 2 years ago, he spent more than $4 million 2 years ago trying to win the Republican nomination for Senate. He lost to Adam Laxalt, who is the son of Republican Senator Pete Domenici. Pete Domenici is no longer with us. And despite Sam Brown's $4 million war chest from 2 years ago, he still owes creditors nearly about $500,000, $300,000. So a lot of the fundraising he's doing right now is to pay down the debt from his previous campaign. And he's never won elective office. And Lara Trump is running the RNC, and they're looting the party to pay for the divorce settlement with Melania. There's no money. The Republican Party is broke. Any money that people donate to the party goes to Donald Trump. Again, Nevada is always tight in the Senate, and its presidential races are always tight, but it always seems to land in the Democratic column. Okay, so this is why I'm so confident All right. I'm going to worst case scenario. I'm going to catastrophize November for you. And this will calm everybody down. Okay. Okay. Let me go big screen here. Okay. By the way, I'm feeling better. Look at this map. This is me catastrophizing. This is the worst case scenario for Joe Biden. I will give Nevada to Donald Trump in November. Now, I don't think Jackie Rosen will lose her Senate seat. So let's just say there's ticket splitting and I will give Nevada to Donald Trump. I will write off Georgia. I will say, you know what? Those polls are probably right. Trump's going to win Georgia. The RICO trial down there has been delayed indefinitely because Trump's lawyers are still trying to get the DA, Fani Willis, removed. Maybe that's a good thing. I don't know. I think if that trial went on before the election, it might actually help Trump in Georgia. Some of the polling says he benefits in some states from being on trial. My gut tells me that there are too many white voters in Georgia who would be offended by the sight of a black DA, a woman no less, putting Donald Trump on trial. That might animate the base for Trump in Georgia. So I'm going to say Georgia is no longer in play. Biden won it in 2020. It's an anomaly. I'm going to move Nevada, Georgia, and even Arizona into the red column, okay? And despite my absolute supreme confidence that North Carolina will vote for Biden, the same way it went for Obama and Biden in 2008, look at this map. I'm still giving North Carolina to Donald Trump. So you ask me why I'm so confident, okay? Look at this scenario. It's the blue wall. All Biden needs to do is win Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. You need 270 to win. He gets exactly 270. Look at this scenario, okay? Biden wins with exactly 270, and he's reelected. Look at that. It's suburban women in Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania who will be deciding this election. I have zero doubt that Joe Biden is going to carry Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. Look at the map. You see all those other blue states? They are set. They are all set. Here is what I'm predicting for November. Again, the only reason you should pay attention to this is because of my effrontery, the arrogance that a schmuck like me thinks I can forecast an election. But I like to be splayed wide open and humiliate myself. I do. I think it's fun to just, I've got nothing to lose. So I like to predict these things. This is what I'm predicting. Now you can hold me to this in November. This is how I see November. Is this it? Yeah. Okay. I see North Carolina, Nevada, and Arizona going to Biden, but it will be very, very tight. I don't think it's going to be tight in North Carolina. They have a race for governor there, and abortion is kind of on the ballot. I don't think it's going to be tight in North Carolina. I think Biden is going to do remarkably well in North Carolina. He's going to win Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. That gives him 303 electoral votes. Trump gets 235. You need 270. Back to the worst case scenario map. Again, look at this. Get a screenshot if you're having panic attacks about November. Take a screenshot of my worst case scenario. Biden gets exactly, worst case scenario, Biden gets exactly 270. That's exactly what he needs, 270. So people ask me, why am I so confident? Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. I keep saying this. If you know anybody who lives in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, all they hear are attack ads against Donald Trump. Now, if you look at that map, every state I marked blue, besides Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan, those are set. Those are set in stone. Minnesota, the Republicans think, is in play. Trump's polling shows he can maybe win Minnesota. That's why he was campaigning there on Friday. Like I said, pay attention to the donors and the polls. If you want to know why somebody's saying something or why Trump is in Minnesota, read the polls and find out who's donating. He's not losing. Biden's not losing Minnesota. The last time Minnesota voted for a Republican was 1972. It was for Richard Nixon, and that was a landslide on a scale we don't see anymore. My hero, George McGovern, was the Democratic nominee. He was the senator from South Dakota. What, boy, has South Dakota changed. And he didn't even carry his home state in 1972. I think he carried Massachusetts because of all the college kids and Washington, D.C. I think that was the first year 18-year-olds could vote, and Massachusetts is lousy with college kids. So I'm feeling good about November. This is the mop-up for May 21st, 2024. I'm David Feldman in New York City. Thank you for finding me. Please like this episode so I remain in your feed, and share it with your friends. Take a screenshot of my map where I catastrophize November and show you how Biden still gets 270. If you would like a free transcript of this episode, go to Shop David Feldman and hit the transcripts menu. Like I said, they're free. And I want to thank the morons who buy the crap at shopdavidfeldman.com, because you buy that crap. I've asked you not to, but it's paying for the free transcripts. How are we doing on time? All right. Iranian state, I'll finish up with Israel. I save this for last because it's going to get a little gruesome now. I'm not going to show you any pictures that are gruesome, but I'm going to have a gruesome conversation with my listeners right now. And if you're not up for a discussion about Gaza, you should probably turn me off right now, because I'm going to end with a conversation about Gaza. Iranian state media reports that Sunday's helicopter crash that killed Iranian President Ebrahim Raisi was caused by a technical error and, of course, Jewish space lasers. Also on board that flight was Iran's foreign minister Hossein Amir Abdahalian. David Sanger over at the New York Times writes that Iran's now deceased President Raisi days ago began secret talks with the United States to make sure the war between Hamas and Israel in Gaza doesn't spread throughout the Middle East. Iran provides all of the funding for Hezbollah, that's the paramilitary group in southern Lebanon, which has been engaging in a low-intensity, I don't want to say war, low-intensity combat with Israel since fighting between Hamas and Israel started. Notice how much better the cough is? Anyway, Iran also provides some of the funding for Hamas, as well as funding for the Houthi rebels fighting in Yemen that have fired missiles at Israel, Saudi Arabia, and at U.S. ships stationed in the region. The International Criminal Court's chief prosecutor, Karim Khan, announced yesterday he will seek arrest warrants for Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and Hamas leader Yahya Sinwar. The arrest warrants must now be approved by a panel of judges sitting on the International Criminal Court, also known as the ICC. Both Israel and the United States are not signatories to the International Criminal Court, which means they are not treaty-bound to extradite any of their citizens charged by the prosecutor. But 124 nations around the world have signed on to the International Criminal Court, which will make travel for Benjamin Netanyahu and the leader of Hamas more difficult if the panel of judges approve the warrant. Although the United States refuses to join the ICC, the International Criminal Court, United States did successfully convince the ICC to issue an arrest warrant for Vladimir Putin immediately after his illegal invasion of Ukraine in 2022. He's been accused of ethnically cleansing the Donbas region, kidnapping Ukrainian children and bringing them back to Russia. Benjamin Netanyahu responded to the threat from the ICC prosecutor by saying, quote, how dare you compare the monsters of Hamas to the soldiers of the Israeli army, the world's most moral military? The nation of Qatar is home to several Hamas leaders, where negotiations between Israeli surrogates and Palestinians often take place. The New York Times reports that Qatar is not a signatory to the International Criminal Court and is therefore not obligated to obey an arrest warrant if one is issued. The prosecutor for the International Criminal Court cited the Israel military's conduct resulting in the loss of tens of thousands of lives, as well as Hamas's October 7th attack on southern Israel, resulting in at least 1,000 dead, hundreds kidnapped and raped. Fighting between Israel and Hamas now enters its 228th day. The threat of arrest warrants for Benjamin Netanyahu was met with opposition from all sides, condemned by Senate Majority Leader Democrat Chuck Schumer, Joe Biden, as well as the right-wing authoritarian leader of Hungary, Viktor Orban. Viktor Orban and Bibi Netanyahu have made an alliance. Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders praised the decision by the ICC prosecutor. Here is Senator Bernie Sanders last week condemning the actions of Israel and calling on Joe Biden to cut off military aid to Israel, a country Bernie Sanders lived in during the 1960s, living and working on a kibbutz.
Any objective observer knows Israel has broken international law. It has broken American law. And in my view, Israel should not be receiving another nickel in U.S. military aid.
Here is Bernie Sanders on Hamas.
Look, the facts are quite clear. Hamas is a terrible, disgusting terrorist organization that began this war. But what Israel has done over the last 7 months has not just gone to war against Hamas, it has gone to war against the entire Palestinian people, and the results have been absolutely catastrophic.
Here is Bernie Sanders describing the situation in Gaza.
We're talking about not just 35,000 Palestinians dead and 77,000 wounded, two-thirds of whom are women and children. That is not the way you conduct a war in a civilized society to the degree that war is civilized. We're talking about 60% of the housing in Gaza having been destroyed, the civilian infrastructure, that's water, that is raw sewage now running out into the streets, no electricity. You are talking about a systematic destruction of the healthcare system there. Every university in Gaza has been bombed. And right now, most frighteningly, according to the humanitarian organizations, we are looking at the likelihood of hundreds of thousands of children facing starvation.
President Biden, as I said earlier, also condemned the possibility of the ICC issuing arrest warrants. But he is working reportedly behind the scenes trying to convince Israel not to launch an invasion of Rafah, the southernmost city of Gaza, where four battalions of Hamas soldiers are said to be hiding among hundreds of thousands of Palestinian civilians. There are reports that the Biden administration has agreed to provide actionable intelligence to the Israeli military to assist them in finding Hamas fighters without having to go into Rafah. Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu told CNBC that nothing is going to stop him from ordering troops into Rafah. He said, quote, "We have to do what we have to do." The ICC's prosecutor said he would also seek an arrest warrant for Israel's defense minister, Yoav Gallant, who does not agree with Netanyahu about a lot of things, including using the military that he's in charge of to rule over Gaza if and when the invasion of Rafah takes place. It is believed right now that many inside Israel's war cabinet are pushing for the Palestinian Authority, which runs the West Bank, to be installed in Gaza as a sort of caretaker government. I know this is confusing if you haven't been following this for decades. The Palestinian Authority is run by a political party called Fatah. That is the political party of Yasser Arafat's Palestine Liberation Organization. Elections in Gaza were held back in 2006, and Hamas defeated Fatah, sparking a brief civil war between the two factions. America and Israel would not recognize Hamas as the victors of that election, and fighting broke out between Hamas and Fatah. What seems to be Israel's plan, if they do go into Rafah, after Rafah, their plan is to bring in leaders from Fatah, from the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, and make them the governing authority. But are they legitimate? Will they be recognized by the Palestinians who live in Gaza? Benjamin Netanyahu said he disagreed with his defense minister. Netanyahu is insisting that the Israeli military will rule over all of Gaza until Hamas is completely wiped out, suggesting that there would be no point in propping up a Palestinian authority run by Fatah if Hamas is still around to do battle with Fatah. Okay. Meanwhile, Netanyahu still refuses to budge on the notion of a two-state solution, which President Biden now calls crucial to ending the cycle of violence in that region. Netanyahu says that he's made it official now. He has said ceding territory now, creating a two-state solution, would be, quote, rewarding terrorism. Okay. Now, Yasser Arafat was also a terrorist. As they often said, as Shimon Peres, the previous prime minister of Israel, Labor, from the Labor Party, as Shimon Peres said, you don't make peace with your friends, you make peace with your enemies. I'm going to suggest right now, and maybe I'm wrong, and this is why I'm doing this at the end of the show, because I am not confident about what I'm about to say. I'm going to suggest October 7th wasn't an act of terrorism. It was an act of war. Hamas took credit for October 7th. Hamas is the governing authority in Gaza. Hamas ordered the attack on Israel. Therefore, I don't think that's terrorism. That's a declaration of war. 9/11 was terrorism. Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda were not a nation state. Technically, Gaza isn't a nation state, granted, but Israel claims it no longer occupies Gaza. That is subject to debate, since Israel controls the flow of electricity, water, and pretty much everything and everyone going in and out of Gaza. But you could make an argument, since Benjamin Netanyahu says they are not an occupying force in Gaza. I think the Palestinians would say otherwise. But as long as Benjamin Netanyahu is saying we are not an occupying force, then an argument must be made that October 7th wasn't terrorism. It was a declaration of war by the governing entity of Gaza, Hamas, which Benjamin Netanyahu says Israel is not occupying Gaza. So I think maybe it's time to stop calling Hamas terrorists. Maybe I'm wrong. What I'm suggesting is you can negotiate with Hamas and still claim you don't negotiate with terrorists. That was an act of war, October 7th. There are battalions of Hamas soldiers in Rafah. This is war. Okay. I may not know what I'm talking about. I know Biden's going to win in November. here, I've thought long and hard about this. I may be wrong. So while some of us might not approve of Hamas, including Bernie Sanders, and while some of us might not approve of Netanyahu, including Bernie Sanders, Hamas and Netanyahu right now, those are the people who have to negotiate some sort of ceasefire. Hamas chief Ismail Haniyeh said he will not accept any deal for a ceasefire if Hamas is prevented from governing Gaza. Netanyahu says, we're not stopping until we wipe out Gaza. It makes it hard to negotiate a ceasefire. Israel is supposedly negotiating with Hamas. They're saying to Hamas, the fighting stops, but you must be destroyed. Not sure. Maybe I'm wrong. Not sure that's how you broker peace. So, where does the fighting stand as of this hour? It's day 228. Israel's war cabinet, Benjamin Netanyahu, the prime minister, and the defense minister, Gallant, are on the same page when it comes to going into Rafah. They insist that's where the last remaining Hamas fighters are located, but they're among hundreds of thousands of Palestinian civilians. The Biden administration is still warning Israel to stay out of Rafah. They want Israel to keep fighting Hamas in northern and central Gaza. That's where war is being waged primarily now. UN National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan was in Israel yesterday urging Benjamin Netanyahu, stay out of Rafah. Here is Secretary of State Anthony Blinken on Meet the Press. Meet the Press 2 weeks ago, explaining why, just from a strategic standpoint, it would be a bad military move for Israel to go into Rafah. This is why it would be bad. Forget the civilians for a second. He's explaining why it would be bad for Israel.
Even if it goes in and takes heavy action in Rafah, there will still be thousands of armed Hamas left. We've seen in areas that Israel has cleared, in the north, even in Khan Yunis, Hamas coming back. So the trajectory right now is that going into to Rafah, even to deal with these remaining battalions, especially in the absence of a plan for civilians, risks doing terrible harm to civilians and not solving the problem, a problem that both of us want to solve, which is making sure Hamas cannot again govern Gaza.
War and violence can be intoxicating. War and violence gets the blood boiling. It makes you feel alive. Throughout history, the idea of going to war, where the leaders promise a quick, easy victory and revenge, it galvanizes a nation. But it never ends well. Never. Never. And yet we still do it. There was euphoria in 1914. Britain was certain World War I would be over in days, and they couldn't wait to sign up and enlist and go fight. They were convinced that World War I be over in by the end of the summer. There was a euphoria, some of you might remember, going into Iraq in 2003. We were certain it would be over in days. I was working for someone who said this is going to be a cakewalk, and this person I was working for went on hardball with Chris Matthews, and Chris Matthews said, body bags. How many body bags should we order? And this person I was working for was offended and said, why would you ask me such a question? And Chris Matthews said, you're saying we're going to win in Iraq. It's going to be a cakewalk. How many body bags? In this person's mind who was asked that question, that was unfair to ask that question because there was a euphoria about going into Iraq. We were sure, but they were sure it would be over in days. You know, think back. There was even euphoria after Putin went into Ukraine. Americans were certain he would be defeated. This would be his Vietnam. This would be his Afghanistan. And he would get bogged down. Remember the early days of the invasion, how the tanks were getting bogged down in the mud? And we were hearing reports that he's going to face a coup back home. There is a euphoria that blocks out anything we've learned from history when it comes to ginning up war. It feels good for a certain type to rabble-rouse. Here is Senator Lindsey Graham two Sundays ago on Meet the Press urging Israel to go into Rafah. And he's playing to donors, he's playing to his base, he's coming across decisive and tough, as Lindsey always does, calling for war.
Why is it okay for America to not to drop two nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki to end their existential threat war? Why was it okay for us to do that? I thought it was okay. To Israel, do Senator, whatever you have to do to survive as a Jewish state.
Senator, again, military officials say whatever the technology has changed. But let me ask you about how all of
these military officials
impact,
that you're talking
about
full of crap.
Okay, that plays well here in the United States. These military officials you're talking about are full of crap. These military officials advising against Israel going into Rafah are full of crap. Now, military officials are saying Israel can't win fighting door-to-door in Gaza. So what is Lindsey Graham? Now, I warned you, this is going to get, you may want to turn this off because I am going to step out of the Overton window. By the way, what Lindsey Graham just said is within the Overton window. I'm going to step out and ask the follow-up question that Meet the Press should have, okay? So, Lindsey Graham brings up America dropping the bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Listen again, okay?
Why is it okay for America to not to drop two nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki to end their existential threat war? Why was it okay for us to do that? I thought it was okay. To Israel, do whatever you have to do to survive as a Jewish state.
Senator, again, military officials say
whatever you have to do.
Okay, that is within the Overton window. I'm going to step away and do the follow-up question. Okay, whatever you have to do, says Lindsey Graham. So, he is suggesting nuke Rafah, nuke Gaza. That's what he is intimating. That means radioactive dust. See, you're not allowed to talk. He's allowed to say that. But if I were hosting Meet the Press, I would not be allowed to say, so let me get this straight, Senator Graham. Nuke Rafah, radioactive dust would spread to Egypt and Israel. Is that what you're suggesting? See, this is why the threat of Iran having a nuclear weapon is not real. If Iran through Hezbollah nukes Israel. What does that mean? It means they would be killing several million Arabs, Palestinians. What is it, 20, 25% of Israel is Arab? So we keep hearing Iran can't have a nuclear weapon. Okay, Iran drops a nuclear bomb on Israel. Play this out. The radioactive dust spreads to the Arab population. There are Arabs. They'd be killing Arabs. And the dust would, if it came from Hezbollah, would spread back into Lebanon and Gaza, the West Bank, Jordan. Even a tactical nuclear weapon, they're smaller in size, that's going to kill Arabs. That's going to kill Muslims. I know Iran isn't Arab, it's Persian, but there are Muslims living in Palestine, Gaza, and the West Bank. Nobody's using a nuclear bomb in the region unless they want to just kill everybody. I know we have suicide bombers in that region, but anyway, okay. Okay, so Senator Graham, there was an existential threat to the United States, and you say, why was it okay for Harry Truman to drop the bomb on Japan? Okay, so let's follow up on that. Are you saying that Israel should incinerate Gaza, but do it without a nuclear bomb? Okay, you can't do a nuclear bomb, but you could do what America and Britain did to Dresden. You could do what what Curtis LeMay did to Tokyo. That can be done. Israel can't nuke Gaza, but it could raise Gaza with nonstop bombing. Not smart bombs. The smart bombs won't work, Senator Graham. So, Hamas has tunnels. You need old-fashioned napalm. You need these 2,000-ton dumb bombs. You need, Senator Graham, since this is an existential threat for Israel, this is the follow-up question that he should be asked. Do you set the entire place on fire like we did with Dresden and Tokyo? And of course, because of the tunnels, Senator Graham, Israel is going to need to run a hose from the Mediterranean into all those tunnels. You need to flood all the tunnels and with seawater, and that destroys the aquifer. The aquifer will be nothing but salt water. It will be like the Romans salting Carthage. Okay? Is that what you have in mind, Senator Lindsey Graham? See, that conversation is outside the Overton window. What I'm saying, just raising this, is really offensive. And it is the question that should be asked when somebody like Lindsey Graham on Meet the Press says,
why is it okay for America to not to drop two nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki to end their existential threat war? Why was it okay for us to do that? I thought it was okay. To Israel, do Senator, whatever you have to do to survive as a Jewish state.
Senator, again, military officials say whatever the technology you have to do.
That's okay for him to say that. But my line of questioning is offensive. Chris Matthews, back in 2003, asking the hawk I was working for, body bags. How many body bags should the DOD be ordering for our soldiers? That question was offensive. The guy I work for said, that's an unfair, how dare he? That's an unfair question. So you say something like that, Lindsey Graham. The question that should have been asked, but she would have been fired, 2 million Palestinians living on top of each other in Gaza, which is an open-air prison. Kill them all? Is that what you're suggesting? Because that's what we did in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Kill everybody in Rafah? Now, we can't use nuclear weapons because of literal blowback. But dumb bombs, napalm, flood the tunnels? Because it sounded really good, what you just said. It really did. It gets your blood boiling. But let's peel it back. And Lindsey Graham would say, well, I'm not saying kill all of them. Just keep killing them till they stop fighting. Yeah, I've heard that one before. First of all, Israel's trying that. The same way America tried that in Vietnam. You know, in Vietnam, we dropped more bombs on Vietnam than all the bombs we've dropped in every other war we fought combined. And people, the Hawks, Curtis LeMay, Barry Goldwater, we could finish. We're fighting this war with our arm tied around our backs. That's what the Hawks would say. We could, if we really wanted to win in Vietnam, we could win it from the air. The napalm, more bombs dropped on Vietnam than we dropped on Japan and Germany combined. We kept bombing and killing the Vietnamese. We killed millions of Vietnamese. And the idea was eventually they would stop fighting. But it only made them fight harder. And Curtis LeMay, who gave us the Tokyo bombings, and Barry Goldwater hinted, drop a nuclear bomb. They weren't saying kill them all, but drop a nuclear bomb. So the question that you have to ask these people is, how many are you willing to kill? There are 2 million Palestinians living in Gaza. Lindsey Graham, you're in the Air Force Reserves. I think he's a JAG officer. I won't do the JAG off joke. But how many hundreds of thousands of Palestinians do you suggest the Israelis firebomb? How many millions of gallons of seawater should Israel pump into the tunnels so that the Palestinians lay down their arms and sign a surrender treaty on the USS Missouri, the way the Japanese did? You see, Lindsey Graham and all these hawks, these sexually dysfunctional hawks, are working off a sense memory of World War II, which is remembered as the Good War. That was the Good War. 75 million people died in World War II, and more than half, 40 million, were civilians. That was the Good War. It's the first time more civilians were killed than soldiers. World War I was a meat grinder for soldiers, not for civilians. World War II, the Good War, more than half, 40 million, of the 75 million killed in World War II were civilians. And that's remembered as the Good War. Now, that was total war. That was total destruction. That was the total destruction of Germany and Japan. And they did surrender. And the Allies were able to rebuild Japan and Germany in their own image. That never happens. That rarely happens. In fact, that's the only time that has ever happened. Most of the time, countries never surrender. The war stops, like World War I, but the fighting continues through other means. Look at our Civil War. Has that really ended? These are the tough conversations you need to have with sexually dysfunctional men like Lindsey Graham, who insist Israel has every right to defend itself the same way America did when it dropped two atomic bombs. You need to ask the follow-up questions. You can't allow the intoxication that comes from what Lindsey Graham said. You can't allow that to just stay there. You got to ask the next question that sobers him up and everyone who's listening. Because it does feel good to say what Lindsey Graham said, but it's what a five-year-old says, like George W. Bush in the lead-up to the war in Iraq. He made a lot of sexually dysfunctional men feel really good in the lead-up to his illegal invasion, especially the guy I was working for. A lot of people, New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman, I've played you that clip. He told Charlie Rose, before the war, America needs to invade Iraq. Doesn't matter if they were behind 9/11. We invade Iraq because we can. That's what Thomas Friedman, the columnist for the New York Times, said. We invade Iraq because we can. Thomas Friedman from the New York Times told Charlie Rose in the lead up to the illegal invasion of Iraq. He said, after 9/11, it's important for America to invade anybody in the Middle East. Pick Iraq and say to that region, suck on this. That's what Thomas Friedman said. That's what he literally said. Invade Iraq and tell the Middle East, suck on this. You want to mess with us? He said, it doesn't matter that Iraq had nothing to do with 9/11. Suck on this. Thomas Friedman, who never fought in Vietnam, but it feels good to say, suck on this. Intoxicating. And Charlie Rose should have done what Chris Matthews did with my old boss and said body bags. Now, to Thomas Friedman's credit, from the get-go after October 7th, he warned Netanyahu, do not go in to Gaza. He learned from history, Thomas Friedman. He said, you go in to Gaza, you ain't coming out. Here is Anthony Blinken, our Secretary of State. Now, I know we have a lot of listeners who hate Biden, who hate Anthony Blinken because of how they're handling Gaza. This is what Anthony Blinken, Secretary of State, said.
Israel's on the trajectory potentially to inherit an insurgency with many armed Hamas left, or if it leaves, a vacuum filled by chaos, filled by anarchy, and probably refilled by Hamas. We've been talking to them about a much better way of getting an enduring result, enduring security, both in Gaza itself and much more broadly in the region.
Okay. Netanyahu is, as our Secretary of State said, on the same trajectory that Bush and Cheney were in 2003. Netanyahu insists the four last remaining Hamas battalions are in Rafah, and this is their last stand, and we're going to go in there, destroy Hamas. It's the good war. They're going to surrender. It would be nice if that were true, right? The Wall Street Journal, Rupert Murdoch's newspaper. Rupert Murdoch never saw a war he didn't love. Headline, The Wall Street Journal, Rupert Murdoch's newspaper. Headline, in Rafah, Israel reaches for the knockout punch that proved elusive. From The Wall Street Journal, headline, Hamas shift to guerrilla tactics raises specter of forever war for Israel, unquote. Like I said earlier, Israel can do what I think Lindsey Graham is suggesting, and that is set fire to all of Gaza like we did to Tokyo and Dresden. Again, you can't nuke Gaza because radioactive dust will blow into Egypt, Jordan, and Israel. But let's be honest about this. Let's have this conversation. Before we go into a war, any war, you can firebomb Gaza. You can kill all 2 million Palestinians. As long as you're willing to also run a fire hose from the Mediterranean that pumps seawater into Hamas's network of tunnels, you can. That's salt in Carthage. That is the aquifer, no drinkable water for decades, centuries. Nothing can grow there. You can make a desert, as they said, and call it victory. I don't remember who said that about the Romans. That also means violating the Geneva Conventions and becoming an outlaw state. But we should discuss that, Lindsey Graham. You're hung over on Meet the Press, and when you're talking Hiroshima and Nagasaki, you need to be asked that follow-up question. Because this is what a lot of Republicans are saying. This is what they believe. This is what they want. Some of them don't even know what they want because Kristen Welker doesn't ask that follow-up question. Tom Cotton of Arkansas said Israel should keep bombing Gaza until the rubble bounces, which means keep bombing and bombing until there's nothing left to bomb. Bomb the rubble. And he's a graduate of West Point. It feels good. And when they say it, they believe it. Because nobody asks the follow-up question. How many dead people are you willing to live with? And again, what I'm doing right now is outside the Overton window. You are not allowed to ask these questions. When you watch retired generals on MSNBC, Fox News, CNN, they never disclose that they are lobbyists for defense contractors. And they sing the praises of our weaponry. But nobody asks how many people are going to be killed by that bomb that you tell us is so smart. Nobody ever asks that question. You're not allowed to. Lindsey Graham And Tom Cotton can say, bomb these people. But I can't ask the follow-up, how many shall we kill? Give me a number. That's unfair. That's an unfair question to ask. But it's perfectly okay for Lindsey Graham to ask,
why is it okay for America to not to drop two nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki to end their existential threat war? Why was it okay for us to do that? I thought it was okay. To Israel, do Senator, whatever you have to do to survive as a Jewish state.
Senator, again, military officials say technology has changed. But let me ask you about how all of this.
Yeah, these military officials that you're talking about
are
full of crap.
Every Sunday, Lindsey Graham goes on one of these talk shows completely hungover and says stuff like this, and they keep inviting him back. This literally gets people killed. I'm David Feldman, reminding you to stay strong and protect the weak. Thank you for listening to this. I am considering hosting a watch party June 27th. Watch the CNN debates. Let me know in the comment section or contact me over my website to see if you'd be interested in coming to it. I'm probably going to charge something. And if you would like transcripts of my shows, they are free. Go to shopdavidfeldman.com. For free transcripts of The David Feldman Show. This has been the mop-up for May 21st, 2024. I'm David Feldman in New York City. Thank you for finding me. Please like this episode so I remain in your feed. If you want to support me, you'll share this episode. You'll copy and paste this episode and put it in a text message, an email, or on social media. I think some people should hear what I'm saying, especially this episode. Please subscribe to my channel and my newsletter. Thank you to everybody in the chat room. I don't know if Bob, who moderates the chat room, is here, but thank you. And I will see everybody. I don't know when. Maybe Wednesday night. Maybe Thursday night, but definitely not tomorrow night. Thank you all.